Dear friends and followers, welcome back to the second episode of the Instrument Landing System. Today we'll be looking at how to fly an ILS by using the Airbus A320. What's that got to do with a funnel? And I'll give you some great tips by using a few rules of thumb which you can easily apply to any aircraft you're currently flying, obviously only if your plane is IFR certified. So let's get started.
1383 runway 27, clear takeoff. United 1538 runway 27.
A quick heads up, I advise you to watch my previous video on how an ILS works before continuing with this one. And yes, the winner of the last contest is Lugano Airport in Switzerland with the current steepest ILS approach of 6.6 degrees, and the comments about the space shuttle glide slope were absolutely hilarious, so thank you much for that. Now let's imagine we're flying from Berlin Tegel to London Stansted. We have left our cruising flight level and we're in descent and approach for runway 22. Now we're at 4,000 feet and we've just passed the exit point of our standard arrival via Abbott, and ATC advises to fly a given radar vector heading of 270 followed by AirGeo 125 cleared ILS approach runway 22, meaning we are allowed to descend down to 2,500 feet as published in the chart and establish ourselves with the given heading onto the ILS for runway 22. As we look at this picture right here, here is your current heading and the final inbound course, and we are practicing without wind at the moment. Now these two lines cross at an angle of 47 degrees, meaning we would have to turn 47 degrees to the left to come established on the localizer. Now here's a rule of thumb which will help you to not under or overshoot the localizer beam. Now the standard turning rate of most planes is 3 degrees per second. So as we have to turn 47 degrees divided by 3 is roughly 16 seconds, meaning your turn will take 16 seconds, but keep in mind the airplane's speed, because the speed determines your bank angle for those 16 seconds. And here's the next rule of thumb. Let's say we're flying at 230 knots, divide the speed by 10 and add 7 to that, and you will get the bank angle of 30 degrees for those 16 seconds. So let's try that out. Now here's the localizer coming alive. Localizer captured. Now we are established on the localizer and we have to reduce our speed. Best to do that is during level flight before capturing the glide slope. And here comes another rule of thumb in terms of ground speed, which is fairly accurate during calm winds. At 10 nautical miles, you should have 200 knots, 190 at 9, 180 at 8, 170 at 7, 160 at 6, and so on. This obviously applies to the Airbus A320 because I haven't seen a Cessna 172 doing 180 knots on an 8-mile final yet. And at 1,000 feet above ground level, which is near 3 nautical miles away from the runway, you are then fully configured with a calculated approach speed and power setting. This would then be a decelerated approach as you are gradually decelerating your speed along the ILS. Now in this example here, I've manually set the speed bug so you get a better understanding which speed to use along the ILS. So we'll start reducing the speed to 170 knots as we are intercepting the glide slope in 2,500 feet at 6.6 nautical miles from India Sierra X-ray, which is the final approach point of the ILS DME. Flaps 1 and 2 will slow down the aircraft. Now just before intercepting the glide slope, you reduce the thrust levers to idle. Now once the glide slope is captured, you set the go-around altitude, 3,000 feet as published in the chart, and you are now established on the ILS runway 22, and often the ATC controllers will want you to inform them by saying AirGeo 125 established ILS 22 in Stansted. They would then reply, thank you AirGeo 125, contact Stansted Tower, frequency 125.55, have a great day. Now let's put some wind into our approach. Let's say the current wind at Stansted is 270 with 15 knots, so 270 is 47 degrees to the right of the final inbound course, meaning the wind will push you off the localizer if you don't correct for it. And let's just do this for training purposes. As you can see here in the upper left corner of the navigation display, you have the wind indication and ground speed. So as the wind is pushing us off the localizer diamond or line will move to the right as you drift off to the left. And each dot represents a 0.8 degree deflection of your track towards the runway. I know 0.8 degrees doesn't sound much, but let's quickly do the math. Let's say you're 9 nautical miles away from the runway at 0.8 degrees right of the localizer means tangent 0.8 equals the opposite side divided by 9 nautical miles is 0.125 nautical miles off, and that's 760 feet, which is twice the length of a football field, so you better do something about it. You therefore have to calculate the wind correction angle. Now, the wind direction minus your inbound course is 47 degrees, so 47 times the wind speed of 15 divided by the true airspeed. And that gives us a wind correction angle of roughly 4 degrees. So you turn the heading bug to 227 degrees, but initially you have to recapture the localizer first by flying a greater heading, let's say 240. And once you're back on the localizer, you maintain the heading of 227 to correct for the wind. So let's look at what happens if you deviate from the glide slope. Now, each dot represents a deviation of 0.4 degrees up or down. So in our case right here, we are too low as the glide slope diamond is above the center. You then reduce your vertical speed and in the worst cases, you level off and monitor the glide slope diamond. And as soon as you've recaptured the glide slope, there's another rule of thumb you can use. Check your current ground speed and multiply that by 5 and you'll get your vertical speed you should apply. So in our example right here, we have a ground speed of 159, let's say 160, times 5 equals 800 feet per minute you shall maintain on your vertical speed scale. These are the basics to capture and maintain the localizer and glide slope of the ILS. But keep in mind, making corrections until the 3 to 4 nautical miles away from the runway threshold is relatively easy as you can do bigger corrections. But after passing a 1,000 feet gate, you have to be fully established on the ILS because most airline standard operating procedures demand to perform a go around if you are deviating one dot off the ILS to either direction. And the closer you get to the threshold, the more sensitive the ILS becomes. Imagine flying through a funnel. You've got loads of space to correct where the funnel is wider, but the narrower it becomes, the less space you have. Now you might think flying an ILS is fairly simple and easy. It sure is if you practice it on a daily basis, but your practice is only effective with the autothrust, the autopilot and the flight directors disengaged, obviously. And flying a so-called raw data ILS, meaning without any help from the plane in terms of flight director and autopilot, etc., is a standard requirement for any airline screening assessment in the simulator. And don't expect all engines to be running either. I hope you enjoyed this video on how to fly an ILS and with easy rules of thumb you can use. So next video will be all about the different ILS categories and why you can hear this call out.
100 above. Minimum.
Don't forget to perform a touch and go at my Instagram account. My instrument landing system is working fine, no restrictions. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button right here, plus the notification bell so you won't miss out upcoming videos. See you next week. All the best, your Captain Joe.